everyone at Vintage Grace. Thanks so much for joining us online. Want to invite you to worship with us this morning. We're going to start singing some Christmas tunes. So let's sing together. Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and
joy. What's up, Vintage family? Thank you so much for joining us live and online. It's Christmas time, and we are in the final stretch of 2020. What a year, right? Let's just take a deep breath this December and rest in the truth that our joy is in Jesus, and it's not dictated by our circumstances. Let's continue to just invite God to move however He wants to in our lives this season, doing what only He can do. Here are a few things you're going to want to know. Number one, if you are new with us, we actually want to get to know you. You can text VG Connect to 474747 and we'll get you connected into community. Number two, next week is our Vintage Family Christmas Party, and this year's theme is flapjacks and flannels. So wear your best looking flannel, coordinate with your people. We'll have a photo booth for in-between services. We've got take-home boxes of Living Proof flapjack mix for your neighbors to show them God's love, a hot cocoa bar, and there's a gift for the most flanneled out family. You're gonna wanna be there. Also, not just do we have this Christmas party, but Christmas Eve itself is coming. We hope you can join us for one of our five services, but if you can't, we invite you to register for an I'll Be Home for Christmas box. The times and registrations for these boxes can be found on our church email or on the Vintage Grace website. Now, if you're with us in person today, you likely sat on what we like to call an invite card. This is a tiny tool to help you invite your friends and family to a Christmas Eve service, including online. Another way that we're corporately stepping into being living proof is through an initiative called Learning Lab Love. I mean, could you imagine if your kids didn't have access to a computer or let alone Wi-Fi and still had to participate in remote learning? There are some kids in the Oak Park neighborhood of South Sac who are living that story. We've been partnering with Matt Moore, our church plant partner in Oak Park, through a ministry called the Learning Lab. And what they're doing is they're helping these students not only survive this crazy educational season, but to thrive during this season. So here's what you can do to help make a difference. We invite you to pick up a box from the church. Fill that box with the gifts that are listed on the packing list that we've created for you guys, and then return the filled box back to Vintage by 12:20. We'll look through each box and then deliver them to Matt Moore to bless some of these young kids at the Learning Lab. I'd like to thank you again for joining us online, for joining us in person. Please know that we are with you, we're for you, and we hope that you continue to discover that there's more joy in Jesus than anyone or anything else. Up next, we have a little sneak peek into what God is doing in and through the Learning Lab. Check it out.
I think when the pandemic began, we all just stayed at home, sheltered in place for a few weeks, thinking that it would all pass and then life would get back to normal. But as the weeks went on and the months went on, we realized that we couldn't just stay holed up in our house. And as we looked around our neighborhood, we realized that a lot of people were hurting, people were feeling alone, and especially the kids were being left behind. It's estimated that 30% of the kids in this neighborhood last spring never logged on even once to distance education. Many came into the pandemic already a grade level behind, and now they're multiple grade levels behind. And many people believe that kids in the urban setting are going to be set back for generations because of this pandemic. So the Learning Lab exists just to provide a stable and a safe learning environment for kids. So volunteers show up when the kids show up and they sit with the kids and just help them stay focused on what the teachers are saying. And then during the different breaks, the volunteers help the kids just stay focused on the work and try to move forward educationally. So many of these kids can't even read. And so when a teacher tells them to do an assignment, they can't even navigate Google Classroom to find the assignment. So a lot of these kids were discouraged, they were defeated. Some of them were just choosing to sleep through class. And so having these volunteers alongside of these students, it encourages them, it motivates them. And then as we've taught some of them, like letter recognition, phonics, and even how to read, it's like giving them life again and giving them encouragement, seeing that they actually can learn. Because a lot of them, the reason why they weren't logging on was just they were defeated. They're like, why am I gonna do something that's so discouraging? So day in and day out, we see these kids encouraged and excited again about learning. So there's a family that's coming, and in their home, they have 11 kids in an 800 square foot apartment. And so these kids were super discouraged. And when they were showing up, they weren't really awake. They were asleep most of the time. And so my wife, for example, has been working with one of the kids named Jose. And he is really eager to learn, but he didn't know how to read. And so with my wife and others working with him, now he's knowing how to read, he's getting excited, he wants to come to the learning lab versus kind of avoiding it. And so we're watching this case by case, child by child, all of them getting excited about learning and engaging online. I want to thank you guys at Vintage Grace for always being mindful of us and always praying for us. And then this Christmas season, putting together these boxes. Those things that you're putting in these boxes are going to be an encouragement for these kids and even incentivize them. It's amazing how just little pieces of encouragement and little gifts really encourage these kids to keep on learning and keep going. So if you guys want to be a part of what we're doing, there's two things that you can do. The first thing is pray. And I know that you guys often set your alarms like at 9:38 in the morning for Matthew 9:38, but consider setting your alarm maybe at like 11:30. Because during the 11 o'clock hour, a lot of these kids, they're falling asleep, they're checking out, they're just done with learning. Another thing you can do is you can show up and serve. My wife, she decided to take like a longer lunch, and she comes just for 30 minutes on Tuesday and Thursday. And just that short little window, she gets to work on phonics and reading with the same kid week after week. So if you guys want to serve, come down even for 30 minutes. It will make an impact. So if you want to get involved, you can reach out to me. And I just want to thank you guys for praying, for being willing to serve, for being mindful of us. It's such an encouragement knowing that we have a church like you guys, always eager, ready to serve.
Good morning. Now, as many of you know, I've been training this entire year to run a marathon. And yes, I'm still going to do it, even though I know that I'm running out of time. And no, I don't enjoy it. People that said, well, over time, you'll love running. Nope, still don't. But yes, it's going to get done before this year is over. And no, I haven't gotten skinnier as a result of running all year. Now something I kind of want to give you an update on is that in a previous life, because I think some of you might really believe that I'm a runner, especially because I'm so skinny in my physical physique. But before I was a runner, I actually was a CrossFitter. And I loved CrossFitting. I know you can't really tell from my many massive muscles, but I loved lifting weights, and we would do it all the time. And one of my favorite lifts was actually a deadlift, where you kind of get as much weight as possible on the bar. And again, if you can believe me, in the good old days, I used to be able to lift a lot of weight. But maybe you don't really want to believe my testimony, because here I am sucking wind, just putting weight onto a bar. But if you don't believe me, meet my buddy Hunter. Hunter's one of our staff guys, and he'll walk around the office. We call him Hunter Hype Man, because he'll be like, Drew, what's your PR? And I made the mistake of telling him. I said, I've deadlifted 500 pounds once. And so he'll run around and tell of his friends, Pastor Drew, Papa Drew, he can lift 500 pounds. And so maybe you don't believe my testimony. And honestly, you probably shouldn't believe Hunter's testimony either, because he's never seen me lift weights, not once. But I wonder why we believe the things that we believe. And so if you don't believe me, if you don't believe Hunter, I'd like to think just knowing how to put weight on a bar that maybe you'd believe me because of that. But maybe this evidence will help you believe. So there you have it. Video evidence, proof that I can lift weight. Not my testimony that I totally could have been lifting and making it up. Not Hunter's testimony who had never seen, but video evidence. And so this morning we're going to look at a text where we're going to see the importance of a witness and a testimony, but also of evidence. And so as we dive into the text, the question is, what do we believe about who Jesus is and who he tells us that he is and what John tells us about who Jesus is? And so here's my summary statement. If you have your Bibles, pull out to the Gospel of John. We're finishing chapter 5. And here's the summary statement. John shows us that the faith that we have in following Jesus is not some faith that's wished upon a star or a fairy tale of old, but rather it comes with evidence that not only demands a verdict, but it builds our confidence and inspires our testimony. And so in the text, we're going to see five key testimonies, witnesses of what they've seen and of what they've heard. We're going to see John the Baptist. We're going to see the miracles of Jesus, the signs. We're going to see the Father point to the Son and the Word of God itself, as well as Moses as this spiritual hero of the Israel people testifying about who Jesus is so that we don't miss it. Now, before we dive into the text, we're continuing on in chapter 5. This is really the third part of a three-week series. If you remember chapter 5, we started with the glory of God being the most important thing about everything. That Jesus, as he does miracles, as he does signs, that people are like, oh my goodness, I can't believe that. The reason why he does a miracle or doesn't do a miracle, it's under the umbrella of the glory of God in any and everything. So you remember chapter 5, verse 6, Jesus takes the initiative. He heals the lame man who's sitting by the pool, and that creates a controversy. The Jews go from being curious about who Jesus is to actually conflict mounting and arising because they can't heal on the Sabbath. And really, Jesus doesn't break the Sabbath. He just breaks one of the 37 hedges that the lawmakers, the Jews, created around the law of the Sabbath. And so that creates this controversy. They threaten Jesus. They say, on what authority do you have to do this? And Jesus' main defense in chapter 5, verse 17 is, I and the Father are one. You're telling me I can't break the Father's Sabbath, but in John 1:1, me and the Father are one. In the beginning, I was there. So that's what we're seeing in the text. There's this building controversy, and Dacey did a great job in part two about how the Father and the Son does even judgment based on what the Father tells him to do. The miracles, the love, the pursuit, everything he does, it's because of who the Father is. And so that's what we see in the text by verse 30. We're picking this up from last week. I don't do anything on my own. As I hear, I judge. My judgment is just. Why? Because I seek not my own will, but the will of him who sent me. So he's saying, everything I do is because the Father calls me to it. If I alone bear witness about myself, my testimony is not true. Now in the Mishnah, which is again the Jewish literature, they say, your testimony is not good enough. If I show up and say, I can lift weight, and it's just me talking, my testimony by itself is not good enough. So Jesus says, hey, it's not my testimony you need to believe. Look at verse 32. No, there's another who bears witness, and that other is God the Father. God Almighty. Jesus says, look, don't trust me. Trust the Father who sent me. He bears witness about me, and I know that this testimony he bears is true. And so that's what we're seeing in the book of John so far, that Jesus does nothing apart what the Father tells him to do. He's going to tell us in chapter 8, I know where I'm going because the Father sent me, that I do what he tells me to do, that I pray as he tells me to pray, and I walk and I heal and I do these miracles. So we're going to finish up this sign and miracle account. Jesus is continuing his response from last week, saying he and the Father are one. So let's pray as we dive into the text. Father God, we come before you this morning. We believe, Jesus, that you are Lord. And so, Father, we ask that we would hear from you as you sent your Son, as you inspired the Spirit to speak through John the Evangelist. Would you open our eyes and our hearts and our ears to hear your word this morning, to see, to believe, and to receive that you are Lord, that you are King in this Christmas season. So, Father, we love you. Would you speak, we pray. And everybody said, amen. All right, so here's the first of the five witnesses, John the Baptist. As John the Baptist comes on the scene, here's Jesus' quote. He goes in verse 33, you sent to John. And John, he was the one born to witness of the truth. Not that the testimony that I received is from man, but I say these things so that you might be saved. Remember chapter 1, verse 7. John comes on the scene and he testifies of the true light of the world. He testifies that the Word became flesh, that Jesus came, not that he was the Messiah, but he was the forerunner. So everything John the Baptist did was to get the people ready to meet Jesus. He was the true light, and everything he does is so that people would receive the true light. And for a season, John's ministry was broad, it was wide, it was effective. Even the Pharisees and the Sadducees, Josephus, who's a Jewish historian, not a Christian himself, he would write as a first century historian, he would say, man, as John shows up, there was a buzz around the community of the Jews. We see that in the Gospel of Matthew and in Luke chapter 3, that as John shows up, it says this, that he was burning like a shining lamp, and that you Jews, you were willing to rejoice for a little while in his light. The Sadducees, the Pharisees, they loved John until John pointed them towards Jesus. And so again, I think part of even as the evangelist writes this letter for us, he reminds us that John the Baptist was not the light, he was a lamp. Lamps are only lit because some other form of light lights them. So John the Baptist says, I wasn't the light. In Acts 19, we see that people missed who Jesus was because they were following John too much. And John says, no, I'm a lamp. I want you to see the light. I'm only here to help you see and discover that we have a baptism of repentance and that he who's coming after me is greater. And so that's the first witness that Jesus tells us. Jesus says, look, I want you to see me. I want you to accept me. I want you to receive me, not for my sake, but for yours, because all of us, as we saw in John 3:16, are living in a dumpster. We're living in this dumpster fire, and John the Baptist came to highlight that and to say, now receive Jesus. And so what Jesus is here saying, he's saying in verses 33 through 35, he's saying, if you listened to John, then you would have actually followed me. Then you would have actually followed me as the Messiah, because that's who John the Baptist was. He was pointing you towards me. That's the first witness. The second witness is his work itself. That Jesus didn't just come and say, follow me. He came and did miracles and signs. Remember, ultimately for his glory, for the glory of the Father. That's why Jesus does everything that he does, is that we would see and be in relationship with God the Father. We go back to God living. Here's verse 36. But the testimony that I have is greater than that of John. He's saying, John the Baptist was a man. But like he was told by God to point you towards me. But my testimony is even greater than that. My testimony comes from God the Father, and specifically for the signs that the Father told me to do. So he's saying this, every time I did a miracle, the official's son, the man by the pool, turning water to wine, the more miracles are going to come in the gospel, every one of those is because the Father gave me the power to do it, and the Father told me to do it. He's the ultimate authority. And so all these signs are really evidence. They're evidence that demands a verdict. Do you believe Jesus does these miracles so that people would believe? Remember Nicodemus in chapter 3, verse 2? He says, all these things that Jesus is doing, it's really so that I might actually believe the credibility. It's not some testimony from afar, but it's real life. It's something that I've seen. In fact, we're going to see in chapter 9, 10, 17, 10 again, 14, Jesus does these miracles. And every time he says, I do these so that you'd believe. So you would actually reconcile what is happening. Why is this happening? I'm doing these miracles so you might see that I am God, that me and the Father are one. So he says this, the testimony that I have, it comes from above. It's greater than that of a man. It's from God himself. The works that the Father has given me to accomplish the very works that I am doing. Those works, they bear witness. My work speaks for itself about me that the Father has sent me. And is that not what we celebrate at Christmas? Emmanuel, God is with us. That Jesus came to humanity. He took on the form of humanity, which is a miracle in and of itself. That is the miracle that we celebrate this December. And it's building. All these other miracles are building towards the ultimate miracle that life can be had in Jesus. That he conquers death in the grave, that the tomb is empty. And that's what we're celebrating this Christmas season. The work of Christ. Now, again, I tried to go this week and actually lift a little bit of weight so that you might actually see so that you would believe. But let's be really honest. Some of you guys, even as you watch that video, are like, yeah, but these are foam weights. These aren't real weights. Or it's like, yeah, but how many of you guys honestly believe? I know one of you really thinks that video was doctored. That's why I try to let the clanging sound of the weights actually happen. But here's the reality. We as humanity, whenever there's a miracle, we said this 2 weeks ago, we have a tendency to examine and to excuse miracles. And so Jesus' first witness is John the Baptist's words. His second witness is all of his works. And yet these Jews and these cynics and these critics are like, yeah, but maybe you're tricking us. Maybe you're fooling us. And here's what Jesus says. All of these testimonies point towards the fact that I am God. That me and the Father are one. And so he goes to his works next, and then he goes on to the third witness, which is the Father himself. And it says this in 37, and the Father who sent me, he himself bore witness about me. It's his voice that you have never heard, his form that you have never seen, that you do not believe his word that was abiding in you, for you do not believe in the one who he has sent. There's three indictments that Jesus says here in the third testimony. The third testimony is the Father himself. As you look throughout Scripture, you're going to see the Father interact and engage with his people. The author of Hebrews says it this way, that God the Father sent prophets to the people so that they would receive the good news, that their hearts would be prepared in chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, to receive Jesus. That in chapter 1, verse 14 of the gospel that we've been studying, it says this, and the word became flesh so that we might see and know the glory of God. And here's the heartbreaking part of the life of Jesus. that Jesus came to his own people and his own people rejected. He came with testimony and a forerunner and with miracles and with the endorsement of the Father and with all the preparation so that they wouldn't miss him. And yet not only do they miss Jesus as the Jewish people, but they actually crucify him. And so these words coming from God the Father, they're reminding the Jewish audience of all of their heroes of faith. Go back to they've never heard him. These three indictments, the first one, it comes from Exodus 33, that Moses, one of their heroes of faith, like he heard from God. The second example comes from Jacob, from Genesis chapter 32, that Jacob says, I saw you, I wrestled with you. Or go even further to Joshua, one of their heroes of faith, that it says, be strong and courageous. May the word of God abide in you. May our strength as Christians not come because we're strong, but because greater is he who's in us than he that's in the world. And so whether it's Joshua or Jacob or Moses, they all had encounters with God the Father. And Jesus says, I came so that you might have an encounter with Yahweh. These Jewish leaders, think about this. These Jewish leaders, they're angry because Jesus is actually doing something that they think the Father doesn't want him to do. And Jesus is saying, wait. Me and the Father are one. I'm not here to abolish the law. I'm not here to create a new religion. I'm here to bring you back to the garden living that everyone from Adam and Eve all the way to you and me has stepped away from. And so I think there's this heartbreak in the statement. The Father's speaking. The Father's been speaking for all of time, sending prophets, doing miracles, showing up in front of the people. And what are we great at as humanity is not being faithful. We're great at missing what's right in front of us. And so he says, for you do not believe the one whom he has sent. You say you believe in Yahweh, and yet I'm the Son of God. And yet you don't believe in me, and I'm right in front of you. You want to argue about these other religious realities that you created. So the third witness is the Father himself. Here's the fourth one. Verse 39, you search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life. Have you noticed that? We have a tendency to make ourselves feel good by creating like a religiosity checklist, a scorecard. We've got this reality of certain sins are worse than others and certain righteous acts are better than others. And the Jews were the same way. For the Jews, they really believed that if you memorized the word of God, if you attached it to your body, if you hid God's word in your heart, then you would have the good life. In fact, specifically, there was a quote from the Mishnah. It says this. It says, the Mishnah, the more you study the law, the more life that you actually have. And on some level, that's true, but on some level, it's false that you can know all the right answers, but actually not have it in your heart. Jesus came to give us a heart transplant. Jesus didn't come so that we would memorize scripture. He came so that we would go back to living in the garden the way God designed us to be. And so what we see here from the scriptures is that the scriptures, you think that in them they have eternal life, but the scriptures actually reveal that we're living in a dumpster fire. That's what the scriptures do. We love the word of God at Vintage Grace. It's a distinctive, it's a value of ours to be saturated in scripture. We love the word, but we don't worship the word. The word helps us worship God. That's what it does. It has a distinct role and a distinct purpose to show us who we are and to show us who God is. And yet these Israelites, these Pharisees and Sadducees, they knew the word, but they didn't know God who wrote the word. That's bad. He wanted a heart transplant and they were settling for head knowledge, not for transformation. Information versus transformation. If you only can pick one, please, we're pivoting. We're pleading that we would seek to be transformed. And so he says this, and it is they that bear witness to me, the word of God that you memorized, the very word, they bear witness to me. So if you actually knew the word of God, then you would know me. You would know me as I stand right in front of you. And yet you refuse to come to me. You refuse to believe so that you might have life, that you might live. Remember, that's been our big idea of all the Gospel of John, that you would have the good life. How do we have the good life? It's not just in memorizing scripture. It's actually in living scripture. Because again, testimony apart from action is worthless. We actually have to move forward. And so here's what Jesus says. I think he's realizing and even quoting one of my buddies, Larry, down in Long Beach. He says it this way, Church of America, be careful. We have a tendency to overteach and underreach. That the word of God tells about who we are, it tells about who God is. And as a result, our passion as a church, the reason why we say things like lost people matter most is from the word of God. It's because we recognize as the word of God shows us that we're living in a dumpster fire, but God, we've been saved. We have this passion to run out to a world that is hurting so that they might actually meet our Jesus. So that's what we're seeing here in Jesus. This fourth testimony is that of the scriptures. Now, I love this because I tend to be a natural skeptic, a cynic. I've studied the Word of God. I've searched the Scriptures. I think that's what God calls us to do. Again, it's not that the Jews were wrong to memorize Scripture. It's that they didn't let it transform their heart. But something I found as I've looked at the Old Testament Scriptures that I hope you've discovered too, that we really want to talk about during this Christmas season, is the amount of verses and prophecy from the Old Testament that actually point us towards the New. All the Old Testament, you know who the big idea of the Old Testament is? The glory of God. Who's the main character? Jesus. It's preparing us to meet and to see and to receive Jesus. There's over 300 prophecies in the Old Testament text that point us towards the Messiah and the person of Jesus. I remember reading as a young boy, I love apologetics, that we might actually know what we believe and why we believe, and the Scriptures give us so many reasons to believe. Again, it's not this pretend story that we can go back and look at specific prophecies that have come true in the person of Jesus. And so there's over 300. And as a little boy, I read Dr. Stoner's article where he talked about the mathematical probability of Jesus just fulfilling 8 of them. So there's over 300. Many of them we can prove and we can see from history. And yet if Jesus just did 1 or just 8 of those 300, the odds of that becoming true, because I love math, is 1 in 10 to the 17th power. And I remember being like, well, that's just a big number. What does that mean? And Dr. Stoner says it this way. He says, it would be like you take half dollars and you take 1 in 10 to the 17th. You would take so many half dollars, you'd fill up the entire state of Texas 2 feet deep. You'd go find someone, you'd blindfold them, you'd put a red X on one of those half dollars, you'd mix them up in the entire state of Texas, you let the person jump out of an airplane, and it would be the odds of Jesus fulfilling just 8 of the 300 prophecies would be like that person finding that one silver dollar the very first time. I remember reading that as a kid, and my kids would say, like, that's big brain. I remember being blown away, and that's part of what Jesus is saying. Guys, the Scriptures told you about me. They told you I was coming. This many thousands of years later, to have all of us in the world that actually see Jesus, different cultures, different contexts, you know the reason why? It's because there's a reason to believe what we believe. It's not fake. It's not a fairy tale. And Jesus says, the scriptures showed you I was coming. So John the Baptizer told you about this. My work told you about this. The Father, God himself, told you for centuries of who I was and that I was coming. And his word that he gave us was a gift so that we might understand who God is, who we are, and that we would see and receive Jesus. The text goes on. He says, look, I didn't come to abolish the law, Galatians, Romans. I came to fulfill the law so that you might have the good life. That's what Jesus wants for them. And yet these Jews, if you remember, they're angry because Jesus healed on the Sabbath. And he's trying to take them out of their own stumbling block to see him for who he is. Verse 41, Jesus says, look, I do not do anything to receive glory from people. But I do know that you do not have the love of God within you. Jesus is kind of getting to the heart of the issue. He's getting to the motivations. He's getting to the fact that you could memorize but not actually believe, that you could know but not know. And something that we love to say at Vintage Grace is that the depth of your why will determine the length of your what. What's the depth of Jesus' why? The glory of God. It's how we started chapter 5 2 weeks ago. Everything Jesus does is for the glory of God the Father. And yet Jesus is going to try to ask us to ask the question, what are our motivations? Because Jesus is going to say, but I know that you don't have the love of God within you. How do I know the love of God is within me? Chapter 5, verse 19, verse 23, chapter 1, verse 14. Everything I do is for the glory of God. And so he's making a connection. Is your why the glory of God, or is your why the glory of yourself? He goes on in verse 43, he says this, I came in my Father's name. And yet you do not receive me. You say you love Yahweh, but you're not receiving his son. I came in his name. And yet if another one comes in his own name, you will receive him. Now, I love when Jesus is sarcastic. I've often joked sarcasm is a gift of the Holy Spirit. The problem is sarcasm from Jesus is always true and it's never mean. But here's what Jesus is saying. He's saying this, you're not going to receive me, but look at your history, Israel. You receive all sorts of false prophets. Acts chapter 5 tells the story of one of those as he showed up and led countless people astray, 400 people. This is Thutis and Judas the Galilean that led these religious revolts against the Romans. Jesus says, guys, you're not going to receive me, but you receive others. Or there was a revolt in AD 132 and 35, or Rabbi Akiba, they hailed him as Simon Bar Kosheva, that he led this massive revolt that people would regularly step up and say, I'm the Messiah, and people would follow them. They'd follow them blindly. They didn't have the witness and the testimony of John the Baptist or the miracles or the Father or the Scriptures. And so Jesus is saying, guys, there's an irony here. You're willing to follow. You know why I think we're so willing to follow? Because we as humans, we actually want to have a hero. We want to have someone that's ahead of us. And make no mistake, I consider all of us at Vintage Grace leaders. I think the best leaders are really good followers. So the question for me when I ever meet someone, it's always like, who are you reading? Who are you following? When I hang out with pastors, I'm always wondering, who are your pastors? You'll hear me talk about Rick or Todd or other people that God's put in my life. I think we as humans naturally want someone that we can see and touch and admire and look forward and say, I want to go that direction. That's a part of our DNA. It's a part of our reality of the fall. But here's what Jesus is getting after. Who do you follow? Who does Jesus follow? He says right here, everything I do is in my Father's name. And yet you're looking for people to follow. You're following the wrong people. Follow me, because I'm the one that's going to lead you back to the good life, lead you back to Garden Living. He says in 44, how can you believe when you receive glory from one another and do not seek the glory that comes from the only God? Jesus says, that's my pursuit. Everything I do, everything I'm about is about the glory of the Father. What makes you happy? Who are you following? Why are you following them? As I continue to see story after story about the American church and pastors that fall one after the other, do we remember that pastors are sinners saved by grace and saints who still sin? That again, none of us should be followed except for in the way that we follow Jesus. I still remember as a young boy, my grandma being so angry at Paul of Tarsus. She's like, he just feels so arrogant. He's saying, follow me. And I'm like, no, grandma, careful. He says, follow me as I follow Christ. As we follow Christ as God's children, make no mistake, we're inviting people into that relationship with us. But as we follow Christ, what are we all about? The glory of God. His glory. And here's what Jesus says. If you're looking for your own glory, then you're always going to be led astray. You're always going to fall captive to the flesh. As Paul says, that there's enemies, there's the world, there's our flesh, and there's Satan himself that work against us. That we start to believe our own press, that we really think that we're the hero of the story, but there's only one hero of the story. And it's the same hero all throughout Genesis through Revelation. It's the same hero here at Vintage Grace, Jesus. God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit, three in one. And so Jesus makes it very clear, I know you're not going to receive the Father. Why? Because you want your own glory. That's your pursuit. That's your pursuit. And so when I talk to people about being one hero of their life, who's the hero of your life? I pray it's Jesus, because otherwise, A, heaven won't be very fun, because that's what heaven's going to be about, celebrating Jesus as the hero. And number two is often, again, if we want to tell our story, if we look at our stories, they're just really short stories because there's not that much to celebrate. And that's what Jesus says. If you're pursuing your own glory, it's going to lead you astray. It's never going to lead you to the good life because it's limited and it's not what you were designed and created for. So Jesus says that. The scriptures speak to one hero, I come in my Father's name, verse 45. And here's the very last one, because we'd be tempted again. Moses is the hero, only in the sense that he points us towards Jesus, that he does what the Father wants him to do. Do not think that I will accuse you, Jesus says to the Father. We saw in chapter 3 that Jesus says, I came to seek and to save the lost. I did not come to condemn you. This is right after John 3:16. For God so loved the dumpster fire. Jesus says, I came to save you, not to condemn you. But don't miss this. We deserve condemnation. Who will condemn us? He says this. There is one who will accuse you, Moses. Moses whom you love, Moses whom you placed all your hope in, one of your heroes of faith. Moses would be so ticked at you. He'd be so upset. Because the scriptures testified, the miracles testified, the fathers testified, John the Baptist testified, and yet Moses is going to show up and say, are you kidding me? For if you would have believed Moses, if you would have believed Moses, remember what we see with Philip and Nathanael in chapter 1, verse 45? They run to their brother and they simply say this, we found the one who Moses told us about. Moses was all about pointing people towards Jesus, whether he knew it or not at the time. In fact, we see in Deuteronomy, one of those examples, chapter 18, verse 15, he says this, for if you believe Moses, you would believe me, for he actually wrote of me. He was preparing your heart to receive me when I showed up onto the scene. But if you do not believe his writings, how will you believe my words? How will you actually be the sons and daughters that are rescued from the wrath that you deserve? And so Jesus, in light of the controversy, these Jewish leaders come to Jesus and they say this, Jesus, who are you? What are you about? You're talking as if you're God. Jesus says, because I am. The irony, of course, is the end of the Gospel of John. Jesus will die, ultimately being accused of saying that he was God. He does say that. He says he's God. He tells us who he is, and there's all of these witnesses that testify of that reality of who he is. And the question is, what are we going to do about it? Are we going to believe them? Is there evidence that demands a verdict? And I'm here, and John writes this letter to say yes. So what are the implications for you and I today this Christmas season? I really think John, the writer of the book, is actually a sixth witness. He's a sixth speaker. And so the question for me as I was studying this week is, so why does John tell us this account? Why does John tell us this? I think it's for two main reasons. Here's the first one, to build our confidence. To build our confidence in him that this was not some random guy that rose up from nowhere and said, follow me because I'm the Son of God. That Jesus' life was predicted. It was prophesied. That there was a forerunner. That there was proof to who he was. There were signs and miracles. That God the Father shows us that. That leaders of old lived their lives to point us towards him. I think it's important, church, that we actually look up and not out in this world. That our confidence in faith, and I say this regularly, at the end of our lives, that we know the final score. We know that we're saved by grace through faith, not of works, lest anybody boast. Our confidence is not in our own power. Our confidence is not in being able to lift a bar or our strength. No, Paul says the only thing I boast about is in my sin and my weakness, because when I am weak, he is strong. That God's grace is sufficient in my weakness. And so I think our confidence can be increased. I already told you I've kind of repented of my desire to get through 2020, to pivot on to 21 as if something magic's going to happen on New Year's Eve. And if we live that way, we forget that our confidence was never in our circumstances. Our confidence was never in our health or our wealth. Our confidence was never in our wisdom or in our politics. Our confidence was never in a personality like Moses or John the Baptist or Philip or Nathaniel. Our confidence is and only is in Jesus. And so make no mistake, it's been a hard year. Even right now, you're listening on a podcast, you're running, you're with your family, your friends, or you're watching from home, and you're like, man, this has been a brutal year, but don't miss that God has not left the throne, that there's evidence that shows us that he is active, that he is working. We were talking as a staff just the other day that this year, over any other year at Vintage Grace, we've had more baptisms this year than ever before. God's moving. God's working. All things are setups in the kingdom of God. There is no bad news, just news that he's using for his glory. That's that umbrella, and ultimately for our good. He hasn't abandoned us in our brokenness and in our broken world. So I think that's the first one, to build our confidence, to say there's a reason to believe. His past faithfulness actually doesn't even just increase our confidence, but inspires us to move forward into the future. And that's the second reason. I think this is written so it would inspire our testimonies, that we would see that people need John the Baptist. People need Moses. They need people that are living with them and before them and alongside them and in front of them and behind them to point us towards where is our confidence. Church, we said this 2 weeks ago, that as Jesus does miracles, I think our testimonies matter. We have to tell those stories. But our testimony often as Christians is not, look at my life, it's perfect. It's, look at my life, it's broken. It's broken, it's totally imperfect, but my joy is not compromised because my joy in Jesus was never connected to my circumstances. It was never connected to my bank account or to the health of my life or the health of my marriage. My joy was always connected to my Jesus. And so when we do get the miracle, we tell that story, but when we don't get the miracle, my prayer is that our joy is still complete because our joy is in Jesus, that he's the author and perfecter of our life, that he's the giver of every good and perfect gift. Which, remember in James, those are trials, those are temptations. And so when you're living with a gap in your life, my prayer is that the witness of who Jesus is will inspire your testimony. My prayer, honestly, is that when you get bad news, that as Christians, we chuckle a little bit. We kind of laugh. We're like, well, I wonder what God's going to do next. Because we can look at his past faithfulness and it inspires us forward into the future to share our stories. Because make no mistake, that's what the world needs to see in us this week. That's what the world needs to see in your marriage and in your family and in your kids. Not that they're perfect, but that they're being redeemed, restored, reconciled to God and then together. That we as a church family would be fighting for our joy in this community. So I think John gives us these stories. He gives us these witnesses. He gives us these testimonies to encourage our testimony and to inspire us to actually share it. And so really this morning, I just want to encourage you to pull out your phone. Maybe you're watching from home. You can pull out your phone. And I would encourage you to think for just a moment right now. What are the things that have happened this year that have encouraged your faith? What are the ways that God has moved that you thought it was a setback, but really it was a setup? And write them down. And encourage you also to think specifically, not just what has God done, but who has God used in your life? Who are the people that God has actually put in your life to run beside you, behind you, in front of you, to encourage you? As I've been doing this dumb marathon training, it's been huge for me to have brothers and sisters that have said, I'm with you, don't give up, I'm right alongside you. I've done that once, I never liked it either, but it's worth it. And so we need those people in our life. And so I would encourage you, I've got someone for me that even here as I'm preaching, I'm just gonna text. Because I think it's important for us to stop and to say thank you for your faith. Thank you for pointing me towards Jesus. Thank you for fighting for your joy, because I was watching and it made a difference. So church, send that text. Send that text to your family, to your friends, to your life group leader, to your neighbor, to an old pastor, to your spouse. Say thank you. Don't stop. We need this encouragement. We need the witnesses around us, the cloud of witnesses, as Hebrews says, so that we would continue on to run the race with endurance. We are all witnesses to each other. It's part of what I love about being a part of a church family. And the second implication for me is not only why does John tell us this, but this Christmas season, who's looking for healing, peace, hope, and joy? Who in your life right now needs someone to be a witness for them? Again, we took a moment to just stop and say, who's been a witness for us? But make no mistake, church, when we say that you're the living proof of our loving God, what we mean is that you're also a witness for others. Part of the joy that I have as serving as one of the pastors here, serving as your pastor, is that I know that the ministry of Vintage Grace is not about a Sunday gathering. It's not about a physical gathering or a digital gathering. It's not about a podcast or something you watch. That you, church, are living out the gospel to a watching world. That's what you're doing. I mean, let's be honest. The question of who's looking for healing, peace, hope, and joy, who's not looking for those things, right? Everybody. I've never met someone in my life that doesn't want to be happier tomorrow than they are today. And so church family, can we recognize, part of why I think John tells this story is because we have a Moses role in other people's lives. We have a John the Baptist role. We have a role of Philip and of Nathaniel. We have the role of the woman at the well. We have the role of the centurion and the leper and the prostitute. We have a role like everybody else that God is using all things, all stories. And so this Christmas season, I know that we're sheltered in place a little bit, but we're still working. We're still seeing some people. You're going to bump into people at school pickup or maybe at the grocery store, and you're going to stay 6 feet apart. But as you see people, would you pray and watch and speak? Would you pray and watch and say, God, is now the time that I invite them to church? Is now the time that I invite them to my house for an outdoor barbecue? Is now the time that I start to share my story, not that my life is perfect, but that my life is broken, but that my God is good? So church, I get so excited knowing that the ministry of Vintage Grace, that the kingdom of God is moving forward, not because our circumstances are perfect. I don't want to be preaching by myself in a room right now. And yet the reality is this, God's using all things for his glory and for your good and for the joy of people that haven't met our Jesus yet. My prayer is that they would see you and your joy in Jesus and actually receive that. And so my prayer for you this week is that you're praying and you're watching and you're speaking, because there's a watching world that's looking for healing, joy, and hope. And may they see that in you because they see Jesus in you. Let me pray for you. Father God, I love your people. You love your people, that we are weak, but that you are strong, and that you have continued to tell a love story from the beginning of time until now. And we've seen it all over Scripture, from Genesis through Revelation, and right now in the person of Jesus and the story that John records. I pray for our church that is listening and is watching. I pray that you would inspire our confidence in you, our faith and our hope and our trust in you. Because Lord, we need it. And yet also because our friends and our family need it. There's a power in the story that you're writing because we know the final score. And so would you inspire us through your Spirit? Spirit, would you fill us? Would we open our eyes to see the people around us this week that are looking for peace and hope and certainty this Christmas season? would you allow us to step in to Christmas with eyes open, with hearts full, and with a leading of you, Holy Spirit, to see and to speak as you open up doors. And we pray this for your glory, for our good, and for the joy of people that don't yet know you, that there's a joy found in you more than anything else this world has to offer, we pray. Spirit, come and lead us. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Well, church, I miss you if you're watching or listening. That means I missed you this Sunday. And that's okay because we're with you. Even when we're under many roofs, we're under one name, the glory of God, the person of God. Next Sunday, we're hoping to launch in to three services at 8:30, 10, and 11:30 if you want to join us on campus. Otherwise, continue to join us online. But let's continue to keep our eyes open to see during this Christmas season. We've got flapjacks and flannels next Sunday. It's going to be a blast. And the hope is we're going to give you something next week so it's a tangible expression so that you can continue to live and love and look like Jesus this Christmas season, because we want our friends and our family to meet Jesus. So as you go this morning, as we finish our gathering, would you go in peace and serve the Lord? And everybody said, amen.